It is the only planet that we know of to contain life, and is the third planet in the solar system. Stay with me in this video to learn everything that there is to know about the planet Earth. As with every planet, let's start with the physical characteristics. Earth is commonly known as the blue planet, and it is easy to see why. 70% of the planet's surface is covered in liquid water, the only planet in the solar system that has this characteristic. However, much of this water isn't thought to have come from our planet at all. The most accepted theory for how water arrived on Earth is that it was brought here by asteroids and comets. When these asteroids entered Earth's atmosphere in solid form, they vaporized on entry and were absorbed into the atmosphere. The bombardment in the early solar system's development may have given water to other planets in our solar system as well. However, their atmospheres were not able to retain the vapor as Earth was, except maybe Mars, which we will cover in the next video. Earth is 12,742 kilometers wide, which puts it as the biggest of the terrestrial planets. Earth is actually not a perfect sphere. From pole to pole, the Earth measures around 12,714 kilometers, while across the equator, the Earth measures 12,756 kilometers, which means that the Earth is slightly squashed. This is caused by centrifugal force, which provides an outward force at the equator when the Earth spins. If you've ever been spinning on a theme park ride, you will see this force in action. The Earth also has the highest density and mass, at 5.51 grams per centimeter cubed, and 5.97 times 10 to the 24 kilograms. This gives it the strongest gravity of any of the terrestrial planets, at 9.81 meters per second squared. Its atmosphere is comprised of 78% nitrogen, 21% oxygen, and 1% of other trace gases. This composition provides life with an abundance of oxygen, and the lack of reactivity of nitrogen produces a stable climate. The atmosphere on Earth also has quite a complex structure. The troposphere, or lowest portion of the atmosphere, is where most of the weather activity occurs. This portion only includes everything below 10 kilometers, however still holds 75% of the atmosphere's contents. The next main stage is the stratosphere, which is the height at which most commercial planes fly. It stretches from 10 kilometers to 50 kilometers above Earth's surface, and also houses the ozone layer, which is our protection against UV and X-rays emitted from the sun. The next layers, the mesosphere, thermosphere, and exosphere, decrease in air pressure until finally we reach the vacuum conditions in the ionosphere. Earth also has an extremely strong magnetic field, which protects life from the harmful effects of the sun's radiation. This magnetic field is generated by convection currents in the outer core. These convection currents generate electrical current, which, with the iron alloy liquid, causes a magnetic field to be produced. This magnetic field is responsible for protecting the Earth from the harmful effects of the solar wind and radiation emitted from the sun. The rest of Earth's interior is more complex than most of the other planets. The Earth has an inner core, outer core, mantle, and crust. The inner core is solid and mostly made of iron alloys. While the heat in the inner core is over 6,000 degrees Celsius, it is solid because of the immense pressure in the planet. The pressure compresses the bonds between atoms so tightly that they return to a crystalline solid state. As well as this, the planet also has plate tectonics that change the surface constantly. Natural disasters such as earthquakes and tsunamis are frequent and constantly change the planet's landscape. For example, why aren't there any craters on Earth, yet the moon is riddled with them? If you look closely at the Earth, you will see evidence of craters that have been obscured by the surface and constant movement of the plates. The Manicouagan crater in Canada is a crater hidden in a natural reservoir. This asteroid landed 210 million years ago, destroying 60% of life on the planet at the time, and yet it is barely visible today. Because of this dynamic landscape, the planet has an abundance of different biomes and wildlife, making it one of the most diverse planets we know of. This is credited to the extreme range of temperatures that can be present on the planet. While the average temperature on Earth is about 15 degrees Celsius, it can range from minus 90 to 60 degrees, depending on where you are on the planet. Now let's look at the orbit and rotation of Earth. Earth orbits the Sun every 365.25 days. The extra quarter day on each Earth year means that we have a leap year every 4 years, where a day is added onto the calendar year. The solar day is actually 24 hours exactly, which is what we base our calendar day on, while the sidereal day is 23 hours and 56 minutes. We covered sidereal and solar days in the video on Venus. A sidereal day is the time that it takes for a planet to rotate on its axis once, while a solar day is the time it takes for the sun to set and rise once. At perihelion, or its closest distance to the sun, the planet is 147 million kilometers away, while at aphelion, or its furthest distance from the sun, the planet is 152 million kilometers away. But this is not what gives Earth its seasons, which is a common misconception. The seasons on Earth come from its axial tilt. The axial tilt is the angle that a planet rotates at, measured from the poles to the rotational axis. As the Earth orbits the sun, the seasons change depending on which hemisphere is pointed towards the sun. In July, it is summer in the northern hemisphere, while in January, it is summer in the southern hemisphere. Now let's take a look at Earth's moon. The moon is the only orbiting body around Earth, and is comparatively large when compared to its host planet. The moon is only a quarter the diameter of the Earth, at 3,475 kilometers wide, which puts it in fifth place for moon size. While some moons are slightly bigger than our moon, such as Ganymede and Titan, their host planets are much bigger than the Earth. This is a problem, as our small planet should not have a moon of this size. The prevailing theory for the moon's formation and size is that a Mars-sized object crashed into Earth during its early formation. This object was known as Theia, and vaporized the Earth's crust, sending rock and material into space. The orbiting material slowly came together due to gravity and formed the moon that we know today. When the Apollo astronauts took rock samples from the moon, they discovered that the composition was almost identical to Earth. As well as this, the moon's density is 3.34 grams per centimeter cubed, similar to the crust density on Earth. With these two pieces of evidence, it was concluded that the moon probably came from the crust of the Earth. Another interesting feature of the moon is that it is tidally locked to the planet. This means that we only see one face of the moon at any one time, because the moon spins at the same rate that it orbits. If we look at both sides of the moon, you can see that they are completely different. The far side is completely covered in asteroid craters, and is taking the brunt of the collisions. The near side has a lot less craters, and more darker planes across its surface. The darker planes on the moon are actually solidified basalt, that once flowed as lava across the surface. The moon orbits around the Earth every 27.32 days, and at an average distance of 383,000 kilometers. At perihelion, or its closest distance to Earth, the moon is 363,000 kilometers away, while at aphelion, or its furthest distance from Earth, the moon is 405,000 kilometers away. The moon's position relative to the sun also causes it to have phases, where only certain parts of the moon are lit up by the sun. The new moon happens when the sun is behind the moon relative to the Earth. If they are correctly aligned, a solar eclipse will occur, where the moon passes directly over the sun. By coincidence, the moon and sun in our sky are almost exactly the same size. This means that during a solar eclipse, only a small ring of sunlight is seen around the moon, and makes for quite an impressive sight. As the moon orbits the Earth, it undergoes the next step, known as the waxing crescent, where a crescent of light slowly crosses the right side of the moon. Once it is halfway across the face of the moon, the next stage, known as the waxing gibbous, occurs. The light slowly crosses the entire face of the moon until it reaches the full moon stage, or when the Earth is between the sun and the moon. At this point, if the Earth and the moon are correctly aligned, a lunar eclipse will occur. When the Earth passes in front of the moon, light in the atmosphere will bend onto the moon, creating what is known as a blood moon. The next phases are basically the opposite of the first. The waxing gibbous will occur next, followed by the waxing crescent, until finally we are back at the new moon, ready to repeat the process. This all happens over a 28-day period. Now let's look at some interesting features of Earth. We talked before about how Earth has a very dynamic surface due to tectonic activity. Well, this change actually happens in a periodic cycle, known as the supercontinent cycle. Pangaea was the last supercontinent on Earth, which formed around 300 million years ago. Around 200 million years ago, the supercontinent split up into the continents that we know today, but this layout will not last forever. There have been several supercontinents like Pangaea throughout the history of the Earth. The oldest supercontinent that we know of is known as Rodinia, which formed around 1 billion years ago. The next was Pannotia, which existed approximately 600 million years ago. The supercontinent cycle predicts that another supercontinent will form in 250 million years, and there is already evidence for this. Australia is approaching Southeast Asia, and Africa will soon collide with Southern Europe. The continents will all slowly come together over millions of years to form a new supercontinent, known as Pangaea Ultima. Another interesting feature of Earth is of course the abundance of life on the planet. Even after finding thousands of exoplanets, Earth is the only one that we know for sure has life. There are a couple of things that make life on Earth possible. First, our position in the Milky Way makes it ideal for avoiding gamma ray bursts, supernovas, and gravitational pulls from other stars. We live in a rather quiet neighborhood in the universe, which allowed Earth to develop in isolation for billions of years. Our sun is also long-lasting and allows for enough time to develop life. If it was smaller, it would shoot blasts of radiation at our planet, and if it was bigger, it wouldn't last long enough for life to emerge. Not only that, but we also live in what is known as the Goldilocks zone, where the planet is not too hot and not too cold, or in other words, we are in the right space for liquid water to be present on the surface. If we were further out towards Mars, the water would freeze to ice, and if we were closer to Venus, the water would evaporate out of the atmosphere. The final pieces are the ozone layer and magnetic field that we talked about before, which prevent harmful radiation and solar wind from reaching the surface of the planet. Without these ingredients, life on Earth would not be possible, and we would just be another barren planet in the solar system. And finally, I will leave you with this image, known as Earthrise, taken by the Apollo 8 astronauts. I think this image highlights the true beauty of our planet, and the desolation of space around it. It really is beautiful from far away, and we should do our best to keep it that way. And that was everything you could ever want to know about the blue planet Earth. Thank you for watching, and I hope you learned something about our home planet. Remember to subscribe for the next video on Mars, and until next time, goodbye.